Christ, like a windmill driven by the wind, round the clock throughout the year. The disciples of Jesus had been with the Master and had seen him perform miracles of healing. But when their moment came to draw that healing power from their inner self, they doubted their ability and could not heal, as we have read in Matthew 17, 15 to 17. And what remark did the Master make? You unbelieving and perverted generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I put up with you? Some of us leaders are trying, while some are not making any effort at all. I pray the Lord will not one day also. How long shall he put up with you despite all his words of exhortation he is sending to you every Sunday?
Yes.
There is a saying in the book of Isaiah 54 too, which says, enlarge the place of thy tent, and let them stretch forth the curtains of thy habitation. Spare not, lengthen the cords, and strengthen thy stakes. What does it mean? The Jews were nomadic tribes at that time, and they were all living under tents. They knew that if they lengthened the ropes on the tents, they also had to strengthen the stakes, the wooden stakes holding the tents. So they had to drive them down deeper, so that wind will not take away or blow away the tents. We have to do that too. As we grow in life and expand our vision, we have to put our roots down deeper. We have to put our stakes down deeper. Just as a tree grows, if it's going to be to withstand the storms of life, it has to put down its roots deeper. Putting our roots down within ourselves to find our inner strength is truly important. The question we should be asking ourselves now are, how deep-rooted I am in my inner strength. Some of us have been in this church for more than 6 years, even though not all of us can be leaders. But how relevant are we in the church? What role or what input are we contributing to the goals and aspirations of the church? The irony of it is that it is the role and the position that you put yourself while on this earth that you will occupy in the kingdom of Christ. Amen. The irony of it all is that it is the role and the position that you put yourself while on this earth that you will occupy in the kingdom of Christ. A good leader will always be given greater responsibility, while a bench warmer and a sideliner will always stand among the crowd by the sideline, while the chosen few are being called to occupy their rightful places in the kingdom of heaven.
Amen.
We read this revelation in the parable of the talents in Matthew 25, 20 to 22, the one who had received the 5 talents came up and brought 5 more talents, saying, Master, you entrusted 5 talents to me. See, I have gained 5 more talents. His master said to him, well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. And also the one who had received the 2 talents came up and said, Master, you entrusted 2 talents to me. See, I have gained 2 more talents. To whom much is given, much is required. And if the little you have been entrusted with is not fruitfully utilized, it will be taken from you and given to the one who has the most, as the Bible also confirms in Matthew 25. 29 to 30. For to everyone who has, more shall be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who does not have, even what he does have shall be taken away. Throw out the worthless slave into the outer darkness, In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. I pray this morning to God to give us a new heart and wisdom to wisely invest whatever gifts with which we have been endowed, so that when the time comes for us to give account of our stewardship, we shall not be found wanting, like the ungrateful foolish slave who went and buried his own talents, as some of us are already doing unknowingly now. May God open our eyes.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
For your information, there are many non-office holding members in those big churches that you see flourishing outside, who are supporting pillars of the strength of their church.
Amen.
They support their churches both morally and financially.
Amen.
With their resources, and some anonymously. They don't even mention their name, they just drop 1 million, half a million, 200,000. Anonymously. We advocated getting cordless microphone so as to do away with the old ones, with the endless network of cables. Today, we are all enjoying the benefit of these beautiful microphones. But those who promised us to go and purchase them are yet to make good the cost, so the money could be returned back to their treasury. They are looking at them, looking at them, and they are all smiling at me now. And if that is so in most churches, why should we find it different or difficult to find such deep-rooted pillars in our own Church of Christ? These are the pertinent questions we are asking ourselves this morning. A lot has been preached. A lot has been taught about our expected obligations to the church we call our own by all servants of God on many occasions, that we just seem to be repeating the same message again and again. The only reason I can give is simply because the Lord has not given up on us and still expecting a change of hearts and determination to draw us closer to Him.
Amen.
And be able to grow deeper in our inner strength, without which you cannot fully realize your potentials.
Amen.
As we look at the scriptures in history, there are many examples of inner strength, but probably the one that shines out is the story of David, the young, slender shepherd boy, who decided he would face the giant Philistine. The Philistine came, and all the Hebrew army were afraid of him. He will come on top of the hill in his armor and with his spear and threaten everybody. David said, "I will go and face him." King Saul wanted to put a lot of armor on him, but David said, "No, I can't handle that. I'm not used to it." He threw the armor and the weapons aside and went to face the Goliath with just his slingshot and 5 smooth stones. And he was able to overpower the giant. It's a wonderful story. But his strength was not in his smallness. His strength was not in his youth. And his strength was not in his slingshot. It was the inner strength of God's presence within him.
Amen.
Amen. And later in his life, when he became king, David was able to say in Psalm 18:32, "God guards me with his strength." Secondly, David has his weaknesses, his ups and downs. He made mistakes that were common to any one of us, but he was always found he could draw on that inner strength no matter what situations he got himself into. He became recognized as the wisest of the wise, and his name, of course, is significant in the history of that nation and as an ancestor of the one who was to come and teach us the way to oneness with God, Jesus the Christ.
Amen.
We are all humans, and we hence can make mistakes. But David allowed his spirit of humility and total surrender to the will of God to rule his heart, and was hence able to repent and regain the favor he had with God. Why is this so difficult? for some of us to exhibit humility? Why is it so difficult for some of us to exhibit wisdom? Why is it so difficult for us to surrender to God and to authority so that we can flourish in the comfort of the family of Christ?
Amen.
Clear your mind of questions.
Oh, yes.
Concentrate and control the mind.
Amen.
You must feel the force all around you.
Yes, sir.
Have faith. We are luminous beings. We are not just flesh. We are made in the image of our Father God. We have to believe. And belief goes right along with inner strength, doesn't it? Martin Luther King Jr. used that inner strength. He utilized his inner strength to rise above the conflict. To utilize conflict to bring about change, but not violent change.
Amen.
He said his aim was to transform conflict, rather than to suppress it or explode it into violence. If he had lived 2,000 years ago, like Luke or like Mark, his words, which are God inspired, would have been part of the scriptures we are reading today. As we had these great heroes in the old days, so God has never stopped to raise up inspiring heroes among us.
Amen.
What is so significant about Martin Luther King Jr.? Let us hear some of his inspirational words. The first one he said was that love is the only force capable of transforming an enemy into your friend. It is difficult. But I've been practicing it and it's been working for me.
Amen.
So if it works for me, it should work for you.
Amen.
Love is the only force capable of transforming an enemy into a friend. Your enemy spites you, will not greet you, but you know that I cannot stand this problem here. Say, good morning. Good afternoon. How are you? Continue to greet. What day she will give up, or he will give up.
Amen.
So once again, we are very minded to love one another, without which we can never achieve anything in the midst of crisis, suspicion, and rivalry. And Jesus said, I do not see a greatest of the Ten Commandments. I see a golden cord that runs through all the Ten Commandments, that binds them fast and make them one. And this cord is love. And it belongs to every one of all the Ten Commandments. If one is full of love, he can do nothing else than worship God. For God is love.
Amen.
If one is full of love, he cannot kill. He cannot falsely testify. He cannot covet. He can do nothing but honor God and man. If one is full of love, he does not need command of any kind. And the second one of Martin Luther King is faith. He's taking the first step. Even when you don't see the whole staircase. It's 50-story buildings. And there's no light to operate the elevator. But faith is taking the first step. Even when you don't see the whole staircase. Faith in ourselves. We need to have faith in one another before we can have faith in God. The Bible says in Hebrews 11:6, but without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
Amen.
And the third one, he said, human progress is neither automatic nor inevitable. Every step towards the goal of justice requires sacrifice, suffering, and struggle, the tireless exertions and passionate concern of dedicated individuals.
Amen.
Every one of us. We are all praying and sharing the same aspiration to moving into our own church, where we shall all be free to worship our Lord with shouts of cymbals and tambourines. We have our children, we have more space and freedom to enjoy their Sundays in the church. The accomplishment of this laudable dream calls for sacrifice on all of us. It's almost 2 months now since the clearing call came to us, as Paul had it in Acts of Apostles 16:9-10, and a vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. And after he had seen the vision, immediately we endeavored to go to Macedonia, assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us for to preach the gospel unto them. Out of all the over 150 members strengthened the church. Till now, out of 150 members in the church till now, we could not count 3 members who had responded to paying only $1,000 per member to start the movement. Out of 150. And we are given 3 months. And we have already exhausted 2 months. We are already on the 3rd month now. And only 3 members, or 2.5 members. Now,